Across America and around the world, you're listening once again to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, the internet list has expanded so large, and it's demonstrating a peculiar characteristic, and that is that so far I have furnished approximately 97% of all the information that has gone across the list, and about three others have furnished the rest. And I got to tell you right now, if you're a subscriber to the Cadgy List on the internet, you must participate. You must furnish documented and or sourced information to the list. You must make a contribution on a regular basis. If you don't, there will come a day in the near future where I will go through the list and drop those from the list who have not contributed. Now, if you're on the list and you've seen the information that has been posted to the list, you don't want that to happen to you. I can assure you. So, get busy, because I'm not one who allows takers around me. Everybody gives or they get lost. Because I give constantly, and I can't stand takers. I can't stand those who won't pull their weight. I can't stand those who sit back and wait for somebody else to do everything for them and save them and give them and do this and that. It's not in my nature, and don't expect me to be patient with it, because I won't be. For those of you who are not on the list, if you want to get on the list, send a message, an email message, to majordomo@pobox.com. That's MAJORDOMO. That's all one word. No space. A little A with a circle around it. POBOX.COM. That's MAJORDOMO at, which is the little A with a circle around it, POBOX.COM. Majordomo@pobox.com. In the body of the message, don't put anything in the heading, and in the body of the message, put only this. Subscribe, space, CAJI, space, your address, whatever your email address is. That means your name, the little A with a circle around it, and your provider, whoever that may be, AOL, CompuServe, whatever. There's a lot of them out there. iQuest, Net, there's a lot of them. So you have to determine what that is for yourself. When you subscribe, you'll get a list. You'll get a communication of the list rules. Make sure you read those rules completely and every single one of them, because it is a contract. If you read the rules and you cannot abide by any part of any of the rules, unsubscribe immediately. Because if you remain on the list, according to the rules, you have agreed to the rules in toto, completely, without objection and without reservation. So make sure you read those list rules all the way through and make sure you understand them completely. And if you cannot, abide by any of them, that's okay. We won't think any less of you. Just unsubscribe and get off the list so we won't have any problems. Some people have already come on the list and tried to preach to everybody their religious viewpoint. It's okay to discuss religions. It's okay to furnish information that can be documented and sourced about religions. But it is not okay ever on the CADGY list to tell people what to believe or tell them they're going to go to hell if they don't believe it or they're going to whatever. I just don't care. If you get on my list and do it, your history, you will be gone the instant I see your post, and you will never be allowed back. And I see every post, folks. It's not going to sneak by me. Okay? I want to make sure everybody understands it. Ladies and gentlemen, the second continental. Well, that button decided it didn't want to stay pushed. The Second Continental Army of the Republic is recruiting. We are looking for leaders. Leaders, if you are a leader and you would like to be a part of a great army that stretches all across this nation, which also is a great political force, please write me a letter. You must have previous military training and experience. You must have good organizational skills. You must be able to keep your mouth shut. You must be willing to execute an oath to protect and defend the Constitution for the United States of America and the Constitution of your state against all enemies, foreign or domestic, and that you will obey all legal and lawful orders of those officers appointed over you. You must be willing and capable of carrying out the policy of the Second Continental Army of the Republic. If you feel that you fit that bill and you're not a nut of any kind, a religious fanatic, if you're not a convicted felon, if you're not a reactionary or a rumor monger, I want to hear from you. Write me a letter. Include a complete resume and a point of contact so that you can be reached. I will do the initial screening and forward all of those that pass my screening to the command staff, and you will be contacted. If you are already the leader of an organized militia or patriot organization, we are particularly interested in hearing from you, although we do not want the names and addresses or any of the particular information involving your group or militia. And no, we're not interested in knocking you off either. So send me a letter immediately to the Intelligence Service, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. And don't worry if you misspell Sholo, it goes to the zip code. The Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. Also, ladies and gentlemen, people are always asking me, what is the Second Continental Army of the Republic? Well, I'm going to try to just give you enough information so that you'll know, because I can't really give you any information if you're not a member. It's all outlined in the oath that you execute. It tells exactly what we're about and who we are. But listen to this. I, William Cooper, the Intelligence Service, the Second Continental Army of the Republic, and all members of these organizations are absolutely opposed to racism, violence, criminal acts, and the overthrow of the United States of America. We will, legally and lawfully, if necessary, and as the law requires, enforce the laws of the Union, repel invasion, and suppress insurrection. If the Constitution of any state or of the United States is changed or destroyed by any method other than the legal and lawful constitutional method described within those documents, we will, without hesitation, as required by law, legally and lawfully, use any method or methods at our disposal, including the force of arms, to restore those documents to their legal and lawful place as the supreme law of the state or states and of the United States of America. We will support any and all legal and lawful amendment or amendments to those documents in accordance with the constitutional procedures for such amendment as outlined in those documents by any method or methods, if necessary, including the force of arms. Anyone who promotes racism, advocates violence, advocates the overthrow of the United States government, or advocates the performance of any illegal act is prohibited from membership in the Second Continental Army of the Republic and of the Intelligence Service. Anyone who is currently a member by deception or fraud, who is found to be any one of those things or to advocate any one of those things, will be discharged immediately upon discovery.
A week before the Battle of Bull Run, Sullivan Ballou, a major in the 2nd Rhode Island Volunteers, wrote home to his wife in Smithfield.
July the 14th, 1861, Washington, D.C. Dear Sarah, the indications are very strong that we shall move in a few days, perhaps tomorrow. And lest I should not be able to write you again, I feel impelled to write a few lines that may fall under your eye when I am no more. I have no misgivings about or lack of confidence in the cause in which I am engaged, and my courage does not halt or falter. I know how American civilization now leans upon the triumph of the government, and how great a debt we owe to those who went before us through the blood and suffering of the Revolution. And I am willing, perfectly willing, to lay down all my joys in this life to help maintain this government and to pay that debt. Sarah, my love for you is deathless. It seems to bind me with mighty cables that nothing but omnipotence can break. And yet my love of country comes over me like a strong wind and bears me irresistibly with all those chains to the battlefield. The memory of all the blissful moments I've enjoyed with you come crowding over me, and I feel most deeply grateful to God and you that I've enjoyed them for so long. And how hard it is for me to give them up and burn to ashes the hopes of future years, when, God willing, we might still have lived and loved together and see our boys grown up to honorable manhood around us. If I do not return, my dear Sarah, never forget how much I loved you, nor that when my last breath escapes me on the battlefield, it will whisper your name. Forgive my many faults and the many pains I have caused you. How thoughtless, how foolish I have sometimes been. But, oh, Sarah, if the dead can come back to this earth and live unseen around those they love, I shall always be with you in the brightest day and the darkest night. Always. Always. And when the soft breeze fans your cheek, it shall be my breath. For the cool air, your throbbing temple, it shall be my spirit passing by. Sarah, do not mourn me dead. Think I am gone, and wait for me, for we shall meet again.
Sullivan Ballou was killed a week later at the First Battle of Bull Run.
So many have gone before us and have given parts of their bodies, their lives, their property, their families, their wives, their relatives, their mothers and fathers, and even their lives. So that we might enjoy all that has been passed down to us, but especially the liberties and freedoms that only Americans have ever enjoyed over the entire face of this earth in the entire history of the human race. If they were willing to give so much, then so am I. And so should you. We're going to take your calls this hour, and later on I've got a couple of things to impart to you, but we're going to go to the phones now. The number is 520-333-4578. 520-333-4578 is the number. I was listening on the shortwave radio for a few minutes right before this broadcast began, and I don't know about the conditions where you're at, but reception here is, or it appears to be, pretty poor at the present time. So when you call, let me know how the reception is where you're at, if you will, please. Good evening, you're on the air. Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. This is Virginia over here in Texas. I have not got my issue number 9 of Veritas.
You're calling the wrong person. This is not Veritas. This is the hour of the time. If you'll look in your newspaper, you'll see the phone number and the address to contact Veritas.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. 520-333-4578. A lot of you are writing to me to subscribe to Veritas, making your checks out to me to subscribe to Veritas or to Annie. We are not Veritas. Okay? Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, Bill?
Yeah.
Yeah, hi, Richard, California.
Hello, Richard.
A little case of the New World Order. Senator Feinstein was the only one of the Ruby Ridge committee that found it was constitutional for the shot that put the bullet through Vicki Weaver's head.
Oh, of course. But isn't she a flaming socialist?
Constitutional to put a bullet out of a woman. Thank you, Senator. This is Bloom, a.k.a. Feinstein.
Yeah, well, it had nothing to do with being constitutional. It was grossly illegal, unethical, immoral. No decent person would ever have done it under any circumstances. And it's, I'll tell you the real truth, it has nothing to do with the Constitution. It has to do with all of the laws that are formed under the Constitution and the way that the federal government is supposed to work and protect the citizens of this country. Yeah, she's a despicable person in my estimation.
Absolutely disgusting and a complete disgrace to the nation and to the people of California.
Yeah.
The only thing is almost as disgraceful as her is that we Republicans put up a piece of garbage by the name of Michael Huffington, who deservedly got his defeat by the conservative wing of the party.
You know, I just sort of on the fringe know anything about that. I wasn't really paying too much attention. There's something wrong with your line, so I've got to let you go because we're really not getting you very well.
Very well. Reception's fine.
Okay, thank you very much. 520-333-4578 is the number. It's your chance to impress the world. Say something that will affect people's lives. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Cooper. This is Michael from North Carolina.
Yes, Michael.
Reception's coming in okay.
Good.
I was interested to know if you'd heard about Fritz Springmeier and his book, The 13 Top Bloodlines of the Illuminati.
No, I have not.
It came out from it's the ministry. It takes Mars runs from Austin, Texas.
Yes.
it's a pretty good book. It lists the 13 bloodlines in the Illuminati, the Onassis family, the Kennedy family.
Have you checked out the research to make sure it's good?
Well, I just got the book about 2 weeks ago, and it's pretty thick, and it looks like it's pretty documented, but like you say, you know, you got to go check the source of all the...
Yeah, let me explain something to you guys. Just because it's in a book, number one, doesn't make it true.
Right.
Number two, just because the book is thick doesn't make it true.
Right.
The price of the book has nothing to do with the truth contained in the book. And just because it appears to be documented doesn't mean that documentation is correct.
Right, you have to go and... You have to verify the documentation.
Absolutely. If you don't, and you believe what it says, then you've just become another, you just fasten another string onto you as a puppet, and you've got another master now pulling the string.
I was wanting to also make a comment. I do a lot of research in the Freemasonry, and I've got your Mystery of Babylon series, and it's a really great series. People need to get a hold of it to really get a good grasp of what it's really all about. I came across a copy of Morals and Dogma by Albert Pike.
Uh-huh.
I opened the book, and interesting enough, there was a caption in the book that said that it was an esoteric book.
Yeah.
And
which means that what you read is not what it means. You have to understand the symbology and the underlying message.
Yeah. And I looked, and there's actually another copy that was beside it, and it was, I guess, for the profane, so to speak, and the copy that I had was obviously a book that was, it said it was to be returned upon the withdrawal or death of the recipient. And I thought that was kind of odd that I could just, you know, that somebody was selling that.
Oh, no, it's not odd at all. You see, that's the policy for all Masonic material. It's supposed to be gathered up by the other members of the lodge so that it doesn't fall into the hands of the general public and the profane.
By the Masons to the bookstore and buy the book before somebody can get it.
Yeah, or whatever. But when people die, maybe their lodge doesn't know they're dead, and the woman or the family or whoever it is, the children sell off all the belongings in an estate sale and it ends up in a store somewhere. Or they give it away to people who are interested, and that's how the stuff gets out.
Yeah, I really like whenever you discuss how the Kennedy assassination is so related to Freemasonry, especially the Scottish Rite.
Oh, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah, it's really fascinating. I love to hear you discuss it on the air. It's good talking to you. I'm going to let some more callers get in.
Thank you.
Have a nice night.
520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, Bill, this is Dave with the reception report.
Hi, Dave, how are you?
Oh, just fine. How about you and yours?
Good. It's always good to hear from you. I usually talk to your other half.
Well, thank you. You're coming through loud and clear. Yeah. It was terrible during Valentine's show.
Really?
Yeah, and then it just started clearing up, and yeah, you sound great right now.
Oh, good. Usually it's the other way around. Usually,
I know it is.
Usually about 5 minutes before his broadcast ends, it starts getting real bad and stays bad until my broadcast is over, and then it gets good again.
Mm-hmm, I know. Well, you're coming through great right now, so.
Thank you.
If you'd like to know.
How's everything going?
Oh, great. Just sitting here trying to figure out how to unzip a computer file and make it work. And
is that from the Internet?
Huh?
Is the file from the Internet?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, you don't unzip it. It's MIME encapsulated. And you have to go someplace on the Internet or on your provider and download a MIME decryption file.
Hmm. Okay.
And I don't know anything about it because I'm experiencing the same problem because I don't know how to do that either.
Well, I guess we're kind of paddling in the same boat then.
Yes, we are.
We're learning.
Okay.
Well, hey, God bless. Just wanted to let you know you sound great.
Bless you too.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you for calling.
All right. Bye-bye.
520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill.
Hello.
Reception's good here in Oregon.
Oh, wonderful.
I heard on the national radio news, probably CBS, about 3 days ago, that the VA was increasing its budget at the Veterans Administration hospitals.
Uh-huh.
And Bill Clinton was behind it. And if they're increasing, oh, and the, they said that they're use of the hospitals is way down. But yet here's Clinton increasing it. So I was figuring that they're expecting something to Philly's hospital.
Mental patients.
Well, either that or maybe casualties.
No, I'm telling you, I know what it's going to be. It's going to be mental patients.
Oh, I didn't think of that.
They won't treat Patriot casualties.
No, I wasn't thinking of patriots. I was thinking of only the people that are in their, on their side.
They're not expecting too many.
I don't understand. You mean of their own?
I said it just as clear as I can say it. They're not expecting too many. That doesn't mean they won't get a lot. But they're not expecting to. They're arrogant. They think they've got it made in the bag. They have no conception of the opposition out here. They're like little children in the closet. They don't understand reality.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it is good. I hope they stay that way. And I hope they continue to rely upon their... Well, never mind. I'm not even going to say it. Thank you for calling.
Good night.
520-333-4578. Also understand, folks, that everything that I've ever tried to do is to prevent any bloodshed in this country. And if bloodshed comes, we have pledged that we will never, under any circumstances, fire the first shot. Ever. But if they force us by attacking us, or promulgating another Waco, or destroying the Constitution, or any of the many things that they could possibly do, we won't hesitate to do whatever it is that we have to do. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, Bill, how are you?
I'm doing pretty good. I feel better than I felt in a long time. I'm finally over all that stuff.
Well, outstanding. I'm glad to hear. There's nothing I like better than a man who's got a smile on his face and a song in his heart.
Oh, yeah, well, that's me tonight. Also, I want to thank all of you who sent cards and letters and all of you who prayed for me during that period of time. I sincerely appreciate it.
Well, I did not send anything, but yes, you were in my thoughts and prayers. So I wanted to tell you that the reception in southern Oklahoma and north Texas is lousy.
Really?
Yeah. It's been lousy for about 3 hours.
How's the weather in north Texas?
Cloudy, overcast.
That's probably why. That Texas panhandle can be one of the worst weather places in the whole country.
I'm way on the opposite side.
Well, good for you.
Closer to Arkansas, and I'm about equidistant from Arkansas and Texas. So I'm down in the corner. I had a question I'd like to ask, though, if I may.
Sure.
And then there may be nothing to it at all. But the last couple weeks or so, you just... by your own admission, been actively recruiting.
Yes.
Is there something that you are concerned or something that you're not sharing, or is this something that you ordinarily do periodically?
It's something, it wasn't my decision, it was the decision of the command staff.
Okay.
It's something that just needs to be done right now. Okay. We need to be ready. If nothing ever happens, it's wonderful.
Well, the reason I was asked is because...
But if something happens and we're ready, we're not going to get destroyed. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yes, sir, I do. I realized that maybe by me asking that, it was possibly putting you on a spot, which was not my intention. But I think that there are probably a lot of us out there that have a feeling that something may be in the works, so to speak.
Well, even if it were, I couldn't and wouldn't tell you simply because I can't allow those who would destroy us to know exactly what it is that we know. And I'm not trying to hurt your feelings or anyone else's feelings, it's just the truth. Most of you out there haven't got a clue. You're not prepared. You're not a part of our organization. And unless you get prepared and get part of our organization or another organization, which is linked with other organizations, you haven't got much chance for survival if you're one of us. And by one of us, I mean someone who loves and is ready and willing to fight for liberty and freedom.
Well,
and that's just
that's
the fact of the times.
I have no problem with that. Do not have affiliation with you. No disrespect intended. But I am not one of the sheeple. I am not one of those people that you frequently address in the sense that I do understand and I do know what is going on and I do know what is at stake. I have said for some number of years, like you, once upon a time, I traveled across the Great Pond to supposedly fight for the other man in another land for his freedom.
Mm-hmm.
I can do no less than my own.
Good for you.
And not that I wish to, not that I desire to. If I could pass it on to another who is younger, do not think for a moment that I wouldn't. But I cannot. I've made my choice. I've made my decision. And this is my country.
Good for you.
And that is not an easy decision to make. But I think that everybody, sooner or later, is going to have to come to that.
Yeah, isn't it incredible that it's so easy for these mothers and fathers and wives and families to pat little Jimmy or little Susie on the butt and send them over to Bosnia, but they wouldn't stand up for 1 second and fight for liberty right here in this country?
Well, their day's going to come.
That blows my mind.
Their day's going to come. And regarding those boys there, I hate to tell them, but when they get over there, it's a long swim home if they decide to leave them abandoned over there high and dry at the mercy of the horde, so to speak.
Yeah, well, this is going to increase. They're going to further dilute our armed forces and send them everywhere. Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, the hour of the time is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. All those wonderful people down there who care so much about what we're doing that they risk all of the controversy and the hatred that comes with sponsoring this and many other good patriot broadcasting. And by golly, when the chips were down, they were always there. When I said on the air, broadcasting from Waco, Texas, that if we didn't stop what was going on there, that all of those people in that church were going to be murdered. They burnt the radio station to the ground that very night. Swiss America Trading found us another station to broadcast on within 24 hours and got us back on WWCR several weeks later, when it had been rebuilt to the point where they could begin transmitting again. And they've done many other things to help our cause that you have no knowledge or conception of whatsoever. And it's probably better that it stay that way. They deal in real money, real legal and lawful constitutional money, something that you're going to have when things break down. Remember the motto of the Brotherhood is Ordo Ab Cao. Before you can have order, you must have chaos. Before you can have great change, you must break everything down into utter chaos. That is what is coming. We've studied them and their machinations throughout the history of the world. And believe me, Ordo Ab Cao is putting it mildly as to what these people do when they get their way. And their version of order is total and complete control. One peep to the contrary, and you're in a labor camp or you're dead. That's the way they've always operated. So make sure you get your hands on some real money in one of its various forms. I highly recommend gold or silver coin. And I don't recommend it as an investment to make money. I recommend it as a preserver of your assets and something that can be used and recognized as real value in a state of total chaos and confusion. And throughout history, that's been gold or silver coin, and the things that people absolutely must have or that they're addicted to, such as toilet paper, tampons, toothpaste, cigarettes, and a lot of other things, coffee. 1-800-289-2646 is the number. 1-800-289-2646. Call now. You know you tend to procrastinate. I do. Everybody does. So you've got to do it when you're thinking about it. Look around at the faces of your loved ones. If you can't assure them right now that you've taken care of business, then you must make the call, or you really don't love them at all. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. And tell them that you're a steady listener to William Cooper in the Hour of the Time, and you'll receive red carpet treatment. Call Frank. And thank them for sponsoring this broadcast. For if they didn't, you probably wouldn't be hearing it for very long. Good evening, you're on the air.
I want to give you a reception report.
Oh, yeah. Where are you from?
I'm sitting up here on the East Coast in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay. How are you getting us up there?
It's terrible.
Really?
It's worse it's been in many months. I mean, I've called to ask what the hell the show's about. Seriously.
Well, we've been taking calls tonight. That's mainly what it's been about.
There was no theme or anything?
No, but there's been some important things discussed, and I'm fixing to discuss some more important things. I would urge you to purchase the tape.
Okay, one other thing. I usually tune around when I'm trying to work on shortwave. On 5060, up here, there's a solid stream of data, like packet radio going on right now, and that's highly unusual. Because I listen, like, almost all every day, and that's really highly unusual.
Well, it may be unusual on that particular frequency, but it's not unusual on shortwave radio.
I'm saying it's unusual for this area this time on that frequency.
Well, I wouldn't attribute anything to that. I mean, those transmissions are going all the time on different frequencies, and they change frequencies quite often.
Oh, sure bumping you off a dial.
Well, they tend to do that. And whenever I'm talking about something important, they try to do that.
Yeah, I know about that.
But there's nothing I can do about it. The people that can do something about it are the people you should be calling.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I just wanted to give you the report.
Thank you.
Okay, bye, Bill.
Okay, before anybody else calls, let me do this. This is from Dana. It's an overview of the United Nations Commission on Global Governance. Our Global Neighborhood is what it's called. It's a book, and you can get it in major bookstores. And it's published by the United Nations, called Our Global Neighborhood. It's the Global Governance Report. You can also get it on the World Wide Web at http://www.cgg.ch/. Widespread criminalization can threaten the very functioning of a state. I'm quoting from it. I'm telling you what's in it. Widespread criminalization can threaten the very functioning of a state. In the United States, the easy availability of weapons goes with a startling level of daily killings. First lie. What is needed is demilitarization of international society. Militarization today not only involves governments spending more than necessary to build up their military arsenals, it has increasingly become a global societal phenomenon, as witnessed by the rampant acquisition and use of increasingly lethal weapons by civilians. Whether individuals seeking a means of self-defense, street gangs, criminals, political opposition groups, or terrorist organizations, the Committee for Global Governance strongly endorses community initiatives to encourage the disarming of civilians. See, you've been listening to me every night tell you all these things are coming, and you haven't been paying any attention except for some of you. And remember, when I make these statements, I'm not talking to all of you. I'm talking to those of you that know you're guilty of this. Just like when I use the word sheeple, I get letters from people just raving and railing, and I rave and incensed because I call them a sheeple. And when they do that, I know that I hit the target. You see, they wouldn't be upset if they weren't a sheeple. It wouldn't bother them. When I walk down the street and somebody yells bank robber, I don't turn around because I didn't rob a bank. Only the bank robber starts running and gets mad and anxious and scared. Just remember that. Article 6 of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty requires eventual complete disarmament of member nations. Did you hear that? It's exactly what I've been telling you, and you haven't been listening. Article 6 of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty requires eventual complete, not nuclear disarmament, but complete disarmament of member nations. And yes, the United States Senate has ratified the treaty and the President has signed it. It specifies, quote, all forms of weapons from handguns to H-bombs, end quote. There is now a strong push in the United Nations to demand implementation of Article 6 of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which requires negotiations in good faith on general and complete disarmament. Even now, there are representatives of what used to be called the old Soviet Union in the United States supervising the disarmament of the United States of America. These words, folks, are quoted from Luis Fernando Jaramillo, Colombia's ambassador to the United Nations and a member of the working group of the United Nations Disarmament Commission. Now, if anyone is still under the illusion that the United Nations is a big, bumbling, incompetent, peace-loving, powerless organization, please go to your bookstore and buy the Global Neighborhood Report. You see, the United Nations is the United States government. You better understand that right now. The United Nations is rapidly gaining power in many arenas because we're giving it to them and has strategies to close all existing loops, as you will see in the report. Also, we found at least one outright lie in the report, amongst many others, but this is the biggie. This report states that there are no plans to implement global taxation and then refers to implementation of Boutros-Ghali's Agenda for Peace. Now, in the Agenda for Peace, Ghali not only clearly promotes global taxation, but our very own United Nations representative called for direct taxation rights during the week of December 16, 1995, and George Bush, during his presidency, said that he would promote a United Nations tax upon the American people. And this is just a little bit, you know, there's so much more. So much more, you have no conception. And now, I want to read you a letter, Bill Clinton's letter to Lieutenant Colonel Eugene Holmes, director of the University of Arkansas ROTC program, which is the Reserve Officer Training Corps, December the 3rd, 1969. And while I read this letter, you remember that this is the man who sent our troops to Haiti, who sent our troops to Somalia, who sent our troops to Bosnia and other places. and will continue to send our troops to other places. The next place will be the Golan Heights, most likely, if this peace accord continues. Quote, I'm quoting directly. I'm going to read the letter word for word without interruption. You listen carefully and then get angry. Get angry. December the 3rd, 1969. I am sorry to be so long in writing. I know I promised to let you hear from me at least once a month, and from now on you will, but I have had to have some time to think about this first letter. Almost daily since my return to England, I have thought about writing, about what I want to say. First, I want to thank you. Not just for saving me from the draft, but for being so kind and decent to me last summer when I was as low as I have ever been. One thing which made the bond we struck in good faith somewhat palatable to me was my high regard for you personally. In retrospect, it seems that the admiration might not have been mutual had you known a little more about me, about my political beliefs and activities. At least you might have thought me more fit for the draft than for the Reserve Officer Training Corps. Let me try to explain. As you know, I worked for 2 years in a very minor position on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. I did it for the experience and the salary, but also for the opportunity, however small, of working every day against a war I opposed and despised with a depth of feeling I had reserved solely for racism in America before Vietnam. I did not take the matter lightly, but studied it carefully, and there was a time when not many people had more information about Vietnam at hand than I did. I have written and spoken and marched against the war. One of the national organizers of the Vietnam Moratorium is a close friend of mine. After I left Arkansas last summer, I went to Washington to work in the national headquarters of the moratorium, then to England to organize the Americans for the demonstrations October 15th and November 16th. Interlocked with the war is the draft issue, which I did not begin to consider separately until early 1968 for a law seminar at Georgetown. I wrote a paper on the legal arguments for and against allowing, within the Selective Service System, the classification of selective conscientious objection for those opposed to participation in a particular war, not simply to participation in war in any form. From my work, I came to believe that the draft system itself is illegitimate. No government really rooted in limited parliamentary democracy should have the power to make its citizens fight and kill and die in a war they may oppose, a war which even possibly may be wrong, a war which, in any case, does not involve immediately the peace and freedom of the nation. The draft was justified in World War II because the life of the people collectively was at stake. Individuals had to fight, if the nation was to survive, for the lives of their countrymen and their way of life. Vietnam is no such case, nor was Korea an example, where, in my opinion, certain military action was justified, but the draft was not, for the reasons stated above. Because of my opposition to the draft and the war, I am in great sympathy with those who are not willing to fight, kill, and maybe die for their country. In effect, the particular policy of a particular government. Right or wrong, two of my friends at Oxford are conscientious objectors. I wrote a letter of recommendation for one of them to his Mississippi Draft Board, a letter which I am more proud of than anything else I wrote at Oxford last year. One of my roommates is a draft resister who is possibly under indictment and may never be able to go home again. He is one of the bravest, best men I know. That he is considered a criminal is an obscenity. The decision not to be a resister and the related subsequent decisions were the most difficult of my life. I decided to accept the draft in spite of my beliefs for one reason, to maintain my political viability within the system. For years, I have worked to prepare myself for a political life characterized by both political ability and concern for rapid social progress. It is a life I still feel compelled to try to lead. I do not think our system of government is by definition corrupt, however dangerous and inadequate it has been in recent years. The society may be corrupt, but that is not the same thing, and if that is true, we are finished anyway. When the draft came, despite political convictions, I was having a hard time facing the prospect of fighting a war I have been fighting against, and that is why I contacted you. ROTC was one way left in which I could possibly, but not positively, avoid both Vietnam and resistance. Going on with my education, then coming back to England, played no part in my decision to join ROTC. I am back here and would have been at Arkansas Law School because there is nothing else I can do. In fact, I would like to have been able to take a year out, perhaps to teach in a small college or work on some community action project, and in the process to decide whether to attend law school or graduate school and how to begin putting what I have learned to use. But the particulars of my personal life are not nearly as important to me as the principles involved. After I signed the ROTC letter of intent, I began to wonder whether the compromise I had made with myself was not more objectionable than the draft would have been, because I had no interest in the ROTC program itself, and all I seemed to have done was protect myself from physical harm. Also, I began to think I had deceived you, not by lies, because there were none, but by failing to tell you all the things I'm writing now. I doubt that I had the mental coherence to articulate them then. At that time, after we had made our agreement and you had sent my 1D deferment to my draft board, the anguish and loss of self-respect and self-confidence really set in. I hardly slept for weeks and kept going by eating compulsively and reading until exhaustion brought sleep. Finally, on September 12th, I stayed up all night writing a letter to the chairman of my draft board, saying basically what is in the preceding paragraph, thanking him for trying to help in a case where he really couldn't, and stating that I couldn't do the ROTC after all, and would he please draft me as soon as possible. I never mailed the letter. I never mailed the letter, but I did carry it on me every day until I got on the plane to return to England. I didn't mail the letter because I didn't see in the end how my going in the Army and maybe going to Vietnam would achieve anything except a feeling that I had punished myself and gotten what I had deserved. So I came back to England to try to make something of this second year of my Rhodes Scholarship. And that is where I am now, writing to you because you have been good to me and have a right to know what I think and feel. I am writing, too, in the hope that my telling you this one story will help you to understand more clearly how so many fine people have come to find themselves still loving their country, but loathing, loathing the military, to which you and other good men have devoted years, lifetimes, of the best service you could give. To many of us, it is no longer clear what is service and what is disservice, or if it is clear, the conclusion is likely to be illegal. Forgive the length of this letter. There was much to say. There is still a lot more to be said, but it can wait. Please say hello to Colonel Jones for me. Merry Christmas. Sincerely, Bill Clinton. This is the guy that didn't inhale. Good evening. You're on the air, if you're still there.
Well, good evening, Bill. I'm calling from Sacramento. Thanks for taking my call. Reception here is pretty bad. It's fading in and out quite a bit. Got a question, maybe this is the wrong forum for it, but you know, if that's the case, just let me know. But when Frank was on a couple of weeks ago for you, he was referring to this topic, and what I'm trying to do in my preparations is decide an appropriate caliber for a firearm. There are a lot of opinions out there, and I would like to hear what yours is on that. Some of the units in this area are equipping with what is inexpensive. And I'm not sure that's an appropriate caliber because it's not a NATO issue, as you know. And I want to know what, if you could, what your opinion on that would be.
My opinion is that whatever you get, make sure it's something that's not going to break down or foul easily, that will last and last and last because it might be a long time before you can get something to replace it. Preferable uses a NATO caliber. and something that is accurate, and I mean really accurate, way beyond 200 yards.
Okay. Would you recommend then units or individuals acquiring one of each type weapon, say a squad type weapon, and then a longer range for different purposes?
Well, that's up to you. You got to remember, mobility is going to be a big thing. And you can't be mobile if you're carrying too much.
Right. Okay, well, the expense involved also, I've got to try to marshal my assets as best I can. And the expense of anything in an HO issue is getting up there, as you probably know. Which is why so many units are equipping with the 7.62x39 pieces. So, okay, that's all I had. I just wanted to get your opinion.
All right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, I can take maybe one more call. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, I was wondering when the executive department was begun to reorganize in 1933. Is there any idea who the actual creditor is?
Who the creditor is?
Is there a creditor for the United States government?
Yes, the Federal Reserve Bank.
The Federal Reserve?
Yes.
Okay, and...
Now, you have to understand that it's the Federal Reserve Bank, which is working through the International Monetary Fund, which is an agency of the United Nations.
Okay. And when did the IMF come into existence?
Treaty of Bretton Woods.
Okay, that was at Bretton Woods, too.
Yes.
Okay. And one last question. Is the AIDS virus, is that from the green monkey, or is that out of some laboratory?
Well, if you buy the green monkey thing,
yeah, I find that very different.
It has nothing to do with the green monkey, and it may have nothing to do with HIV.
Yeah.
But whatever it is, and let me tell you this. There's somebody out there trying to tell you that AIDS doesn't exist, that it's caused by the medicine that you're given for AIDS.
Right.
Well, first you have to have AIDS before they give you the medicine, so don't believe that baloney either.
Okay.
Okay?
Right.
Thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
Good night, folks. And as usual, and I mean this from my heart, God bless you all.